Thank you for being here. I know that the first day of DEFCON, it's hard to get up so early. So thank you all for being here. So this is Cesare Pizzi. My name is Cesare Pizzi, and this is the Ardusploit presentation. So Ardusploit is a proof of concept of the an Arduino code injection. So what I try to do is to inject some arbitrary code in a working sketch without knowing the source code, without knowing how it works, and so on. So try to put some arbitrary code there. Okay, so let's start. So a few words about me before starting. Okay, my real job, let's say, it's as I say, I work as a security engineer in an Italian company. And then, okay, as a hobby, I have everything more or less that it's technologically related. I worked on a lot of open source projects and so on. And so I worked a lot also on hardware, on the hardware field, starting from more or less 2009, working on the first Arduino version and so on. I also built a custom Arduino compatible board with a GPS tracker called Here You Are. You can find all the details here in the site. Okay, so let's jump immediately into the presentation. So the basic idea of the project was actually to put some code in a working sketch. So this will be probably the main steps we have to follow to do it. The first one, it's dump the flash content. So we have the content of the board. We have to get it in some ways. Then we have to modify it because we need to put our code there and leave it the previous functionalities working. And then refresh the injected code back into the board. We will see together that there were more than one way to do this. This is the important part, inject the payload. I don't know if you are aware of how the Arduino board works. In any case, usually it has a main loop that is repeatedly executed. And one of the option was to put the code there. But it was I didn't go in that way because it was more difficult to have a control on how often this code will be executed, actually. And so I try to follow a different path to do it, and we will see it together. I would like to split the presentation in three parts mainly. One with an overview of the AVR architecture. AVR, it's the MCU on which the Arduino is based. So I would like to do this just to have the same common ground to start up. Then we will see how the scripted work, and then we will also have a live demo to see the script, how it works and how it can get the code executed. Okay, just a very, very, very fast overview on the AVR architecture. Okay, flash, EEPROM, and RAM are all integrated on the same chip, so the AVR chips holds everything in one piece of hardware. No, you don't have to mess with other components there, so you can just go with the same chip. All the program instructions are stored into the flash. This is very important to remember because we are going to mess with this code, so we know that it's everything is there, so we can get it. There is also an EEPROM available for permanent data storing. Okay, this is accessible through usual macros and so on. Then we have to consider that all the MCU are 8-bit, but the instruction set is built on instructions that are built on one or two 16-bit words. That means that the opcodes will be 16 or 32-bit words, 32 bits. All the opcodes are very well documented in the AVR data sheets and sites, so you can get all the documentation there. It's very well done. It is very important if you are going to start to play with this, because obviously we are working at assembly level at this point, so we are going to inject some assembly code directly into the working code. Okay, as the last part, okay, all the instructions are one or two clock cycles, except jump and call that requires three or four clock cycles. Consider also that jump and calls are the few instructions that are 32 bits. This is because they have to address the all memory of the of the VMCU, and so they rely on the 32 bits to get to be able to set the correct address to the jump. This is the absolute jump and absolute call. So there will be also the relative jumps available in the opcodes of the MCU. This is how the flash memory it's organized. Very important, because the flash memory will be our playground here, and we are going to make some modification there to put our injected code. Okay, this is the main format. We have the flash memory starting at address zero there, where we have immediately a jump to the program start. So the real application will start here. All the room granted by the first part of the memory, it's for the interrupt vector table. We will go into details about this after, because it's very important. Then there is the application section. Here it's where the code of the user, that the user will write with the proper ID, it's placed. And then there is the bootloader section at the end. The bootloader section is especially important because it allows to and manage easily the content of the flash. Because the, as you probably know, but I'm not sure if everyone knows that, the AVR MCU can be programmed by using an external programmer, so you don't have the need of the bootloader in that case, or you can just use the board itself. Because the bootloader in this case, it's able to get from to understand if from the USB port something is coming, and it's able to rewrite the complete content of the flash over. So this will is what allow us, for example, to use Arduino or similar boards directly with USB connection to program them. If you remove in some way the bootloader, you will end up with a bricked, let's say, board. This happens if you start to play with the flash, but it's also true that it's easy to fix, because you can reload the bootloader very easily with an external hardware. That could be another Arduino board, for example. So it's very easy to fix in this case. Consider that the whole memory is not protected in any way, so there are no protection for system or other ways. You can write everywhere if you want. That means also that you can also damage something if you are not paying attention to what you are writing, because there are no protection at all on the flash. So for the chip itself, you can write everywhere what you want. This way, it's easy for us so that we can inject our code without check so much things, but it's also dangerous because it allows us to make damage to the memory itself. So another important things to consider are the fuses. Fuses are a set of bits used by the MCU to store the initial configuration, like, for example, the clock speed, the watchdog timer, and the bootloader location. I underline this because this is important. We need to understand if there is a bootloader in the flash, because we have to stay away from it when we are going to modify the code to inject our payload. We have to stay away, because otherwise we are going to probably brick the MCU. So the bootloader location is stored in these bits here in a way that it's documented in the datasheet. The AVR datasheet says how to set this bit and how to set the proper bits to give the proper address for the code itself. Or you can use, for example, an utility like this one, which is a site that will be referenced in the presentation reference here. By using some pull-downs menu or some check, you can, for example, as you can see here, set the bootloader present and where it is placed, so at this address. You can choose this. If you press then a button on the site, this will compute for you the values of the fuses bits that you have to set to get this value written on the board. Consider that the fuses bits can only be read, but to be written, that requires a specific external programmer. So you can read them with the usual utilities. We will use the common AVR utilities to perform our job. So if you download the Arduino IDE, everything is already there. You have all the utilities you need to go ahead with what we are doing tonight, this evening. Okay, the bootloader, it's just a section of code like all the other sections of the flash, but with specific behavior and duties. So when the AVR, it's power or reset, it starts the boot sequence. So depending on the fuzzy status, as we said, it starts from the address zero, where you have the jump to the program start, or it starts the bootloader. The bootloader has these functionalities, but they may have also others, like initializing the controller peripheral, load selected user application, and upload new code, for example, by using the USB connection. So that's very important. And so what we need to do is to avoid to mess up with the bootloader code. You can also decide to get rid of the bootloader when you are programming an Arduino on a VR board, because mainly the main reason why you want to do it is to save space. When you have to deal with 32 kilobytes of RAM of flash, you have situation where the additional 2 or 4 kilobytes used by the bootloader are very important. So you may want to not use it. So if you don't want to use it, you just have to set the fuses accordingly, and you can use the bootloader area without any damage. Consider that the Arduxploit, which is the script that will automate this process, it's independent on the presence of the bootloader. So it will work with a dumped content. There is no problem if it has been obtained through the bootloader, through the AVR dude, through an external program. It just works with the dumped flash. So let's go a bit into the internal vector table, because I said before my main target was to inject the payload. I said before, okay, well, I can put it into the main loop, but I lose control on it. And so the other solution was to try to use interrupts on the board itself. What is an interrupt? It's a way MCU and CPUs use to execute asynchronous code. So when there is an asynchronous event on an MCU or an CPU, usually it is handled by an interrupt, because the program flow can be at this point interrupted by these calls coming from external events like a keyboard press or something like that. So probably you already know this. So as we said before, the interrupt vector table is at the beginning of the flash. True for the Arduino device, AVR is also used by other devices, not only for Arduino. And so this could be also placed in other place. And this is defined by these values, which are the boot RST fuse bit, the IVCell bit in MCU control register. These are data coming from the AVR datasheet. So you can have a look to them. A very important thing to say is that AVR and Atmel, do really a very good job in providing the documentation of their MCU. So you can find everything very easily about how the MCU are working. So, okay, this is the interrupt vector table. This is coming from, on the left side, you see the description coming from the datasheet. On the right side, you see the disassembled from a dump of the flash RAM. As you can see, okay, this is the table. It describes the position and which kind of function is handled by this specific interrupt. In the reality, it's just a jump. So it's an absolute jump to a specific location. As you can see here, most of these jumps are pointing to the same location, which is, in this case, it's 0xBA, xHMLBA. This means that it's not used. So the interrupt vector is not used because it's jumping. If you are going to check this address, it's just a jump back to the zero location, so at the beginning of the program. So when you see something different like this one, that means that the interrupt vector is in use, and this is the, actually the address of the ISR, which is the interrupt service routing. So the specific code will be executed when a specific interrupt is triggered. This output, very important, it's coming out from a very neat utility in the AVR toolchain coming with the Arduino environment, which is the AVR object dump. This is the most useful utility you have to use if you want to start to play with assembly and the Atmel architecture and the AVR architecture. So it will be your friend in these cases. Okay. Different MCU may have different behaviors. Because, for example, the position of the vector interrupt can be different. And important that these things I realized when I was working to this project, for some specific MCU, you have different the interrupt vector table is built in a different way. For example, for the 80 mega to 560, which is the biggest one in this family of the Atmel MCU, the developers choose to a different way to organize the memory of the compiled program, because consider that one important thing: the interrupt vector table is built by the compiler. So when the compiler creates the content of the flash and it uploads it on the MCU, it will prepare also the interrupt vector table depending on what it has been done on the in the sketch. The GCC developers choose to go for a different solution for the 80 mega, and they use relative jumps with a 16-bit opcode instead of the absolute jump. I can guess the reason of this choice because the 80 mega has 256 kilobytes of RAM. It cannot be addressed by the absolute jump in any case. So probably they choose to using a paging management of the memory by using the relative jumps. And so probably that's why they choose this way to call the routings. But in any case, the hard exploit, my script will take care of this. And depending on the MCU we are going to inject the code, it will act accordingly. So OK, the last important thing is the entry point of the of the sketch of the program we are going to modify. So we said that we are going to use an interrupt to inject our code, but that means that also these interrupts must be initialized somewhere, because otherwise if you just go to place some code and modify the jump we saw before at the beginning without saying anything else to the MCU, I will not get anything, because the interrupt itself is not initialized. So I need to find the entry point of the sketch itself to initialize the interrupt vector I'm using and say, OK, execute this every now and then when I tell you, and go ahead with the code. This is a specific section got from the AVR object dump I said before, run with this syntax here. And this is more or less from 99% of the code I checked, where the initialization of the code itself begins. So the compiler, after the jump of the at the location zero, and then it comes here, it executes these two jumps, and then there is this closing jump to zero again here. This is where the preamble routings of the compiler are handling over the control to the application, let's say. And so this is where we need to look for the proper entry point, because if we put our initialization routing too early, it will be overwritten by the initial setup done by the compiler itself. So we need to find out the proper way to put, the proper place to put our code here. And so this will be where we have to find out. My script will automate this process, and it has also some built-in addresses where I know for some program we can safely inject our code. This is not it will not work for every single sketch. This requires a bit of manual processing in case, so you have to have a look around this address here or here, mainly here, to find the proper place if it is not working automatically as we expect. So this is the entry point where we need to do our job. As we said, we need to dump the content of the flash because we need to get out from the board itself what is already running there. And okay, this is just the syntax of the well-known AVRDUDE utility. In order to, it's just define which kind of processor we are working on and the speed of the boot rate for the port and so on. And this is the important part. This is saying, okay, read the content of the flash and write it on the .x file. This dot comma I here say specify the format of the output file, which will be in this case the hex file. You can also dump the content into binary files. In this case, we are going to use the hex file because it will be easier to manage through the script. The script itself will take care of everything, so you don't have to mess up with the format. It will get this specific format and it will change everything to inject the payload. This is how exactly looks an hex file dumped from an Arduino. The format is a standard one, so it's not nothing very custom or something. This is the description, so you have a line start with the column, the byte count for the line, the address where the program, the bytecode are written. A record type, it's always zero for the dumped content of the AVRDUDE. Then there is the data. This is actually assembly code. Consider that and keep into consideration that the MCU are little endian architecture, so the bytes are swapped. So here you have to swap the bytes to read the proper code of the assembly line. And then there is a checksum at the end for the line. The Arduino exploit will modify this everything, and the checksum as well, so you don't have to take care of this. Okay. Let's prepare something to inject. This is the hello world for the hardware hacking, so a blinking LED. This is the assembly code to blink a LED on a specific board. This could be different depending on the board you are working with, because, for example, we will see during the live demo, we will make an Arduino Uno blinking. The LED is on a specific line of the MCU, in this case. And so it is defined here, which is the first instruction here. Obviously, if you are working, and we can see if you have time, with another board like the Arduino Micro, for example, the LED is in another port, so we have to change this. But the script will provide some example payloads already done for different architectures. So also these things will be automated. This is just a bunch of assembly. No. Okay, as I said, we have most different of them for specific different boards. I prepared this in the script. The script itself is written in Python. I'm not a Python guru, you will see it. I choose Python because it was easy to understand and to write the script in, but there are a lot of room for improvements in my encoding there. So you can also help me in doing this, because obviously this will be everything will be open source, so everything will be available for modification. So let's go on. Okay. We said before that we may have, we are going to use an interrupt, but the interrupt can be also already in use. We said that we are going to inject code in an unknown application. So if the interrupt itself is already used, we have to handle the situation. And the script itself is able to do it. Actually, it will check if the interrupt we chose it's already in use, and it prepend our code to the existing routing, so that everything will be executed, and then there will be a jump to the original routing, leaving the original functionalities untouched. Important thing to say when you write your payload here, it's that you need to leave everything untouched. So you have to push and pop every single variable you are going to use in your assembly language to the original value, because since you don't know when exactly your code will be executed, it can be executed in a time that you don't know, and you don't know that the application where you are working on. It's very important that you don't touch anything on what is in the stack, and you leave it exactly as it was. Okay, so this is the portion. That's why I told you that I'm not a Python programmer, so you will see that. Okay, it could be written probably better, where we can take care of the presence of the existing ISR, and the script itself is going to inject the code. Okay, we said that we are going to use an interrupt. Which one? We can choose, because the script itself, it's not, it can be also modified. But I, for this presentation, I try to use the timer interrupt. There are different timer interrupts in the AVR architecture. Some 8 bits, some 16 bits, different also depending on the boards. What is a timer interrupt? It's a specific interrupt. It's called every now and then, so with a specific interval we decide. So we can say, okay, execute this interrupt every 1 second. Okay? And the number of bits of the interrupts are defining the value of this interval we can define. So the bigger, the great delay we can have between the two execution. Timers are increased at each clock tick. In CTC mode, the interrupt is triggered when the timer reaches a specific value. And so this is what we have to do. So we have to write our initialization code in order to initialize the interrupt to be executed when we want. By choosing the matching value and speed, you can control the frequency. So we can control how often our code will be executed. Okay, so the timer speed, the MCU are working at 16 megahertz, so we have a tick every 0, then 63, which is every 4 milliseconds, but you can also control the speed with a prescaler, so you can slow down this this counter, and so have the execution not every 4 milliseconds, but maybe also with greater values. So, okay, the prescaler, okay, is the value that you can use to slow down this execution, and it's set through the specific register on the MCU itself, which is documented as well as all the other things in the datasheets, and so you can specify it by setting these bits here, and we will see that our initialization code is doing is actually set up all these bits to set up the interrupt timer to the proper values. Okay, this is a quick computation of how we can compute the frequency. So the interrupt is triggered when the ticks reach the value in the compare match register. And to compute the value, I have to do some math, like dividing 16 million by the prescaler value here and by the frequency we want. For example, if we want an execution of 2 per second, so every half a second, we have to set up the compare match register to this value. And this is what exactly we are doing here with this set of code. This is the macros used in the Arduino IDE, and this is the translation in assembly language. This will be the portion of code that I defined as initialization of the interrupt. So we have to put this at the beginning in some way of the sketch, and then inject our code in the interrupt table. So Okay, we have to find free space obviously to do this because we need to add some code to the existing one. Okay, as we said at the beginning, we have to avoid the bootloader RF present because otherwise we are going to break up things. We have to look for a user space, which is usually marked as 0xFF. And so the script itself try to find the proper online space, unused space. But okay, what if the space is not available? We may have two conditions. You don't have a space marked as a 0xFF because maybe a bigger program was loaded on the sketch, on the MCU before, and then replaced with something else, or because it's actually everything it's used. If in the second case, you don't have any way to inject the code actually, because okay, you don't have free space on the flash ROM. But in the first one, yes, because you can in the script specify manually the address to put the code. Okay, and this is what then the script will do to prepare the code to be injected back. So it will take care of all the alignment and so on, and it will prepare the X file, as we said before, ready to be injected. Okay, do you remember the last slide we saw at the beginning with the flash memory structure? This is what we are going to modify, actually. So intervector table, we will get the jump to the routing, and we will modify it to with a jump of our injected code here. And then we have to initialize the timer here. We have to find the free space and allocate our code. So as you can see, you need a bit of space to inject these two portions of code here. Okay, what ArduSploit can do automatically? Because okay, we now spoke about what should be done, but okay, what the script itself is doing. So it gives you some example payloads ready to be modified. Okay, it's blinking LED, but it could be also something different. It has a ready and usable interrupt initialization routing, which will be injected in the proper place. It finds free space in the flash to place the payload and the interrupt initialization routing. It places the code and takes care of the replaced code, because obviously we are going to modify the existing flash. So everything that is already existing and we are going to overwrite and it needs to be executed again at the end of our code. So it will take care of this and it will automatically manage also the presence of an existing interrupt service routing, managing and placing all the needed opcodes. So everything will be done automatically by the script. And then it generates an output which will be a hex file ready to be written back on the flash. As I said, it's independent on the way we are using. We can use a vRDUD, we can use an external programmer or something like that. So this is external to the script itself. So this is what exactly what the script is doing. Okay, there are a few options available on the scripts. Okay, verbose output, dry run, we will see maybe the live demo. The possibility to specify where to place the payload and the initialization payload, otherwise it will be automatically computed. And okay, they specify the MCU to work with, because every MCU have different behaviors. Okay, we can also automate the process. We will see it during the live demo with a $13 device, which is a Linky Smart or similar. The important is to have the Python support. A hot plug to demo script, which is just a demo that recognizes that something has been plugged into the USB. The ArduSploit script, the vRDUD, in 30 seconds, you can inject the code without tapping any command. We will see also this during the presentation. So this is the hardware needed for example, doing this automatic injection. So it's just okay. This board here, this is an unusual Arduino device. And the software, it's just a few configuration here, just to recognize that an Arduino device has been plugged in with this one, and then just the execution of the AVR exploit script itself. So this is what will what is exactly doing the injection. Okay, so we can go through the live demo. Okay, let me now have a look. Okay, so do you see? Okay, and okay, so let's move. Okay, this is a temporary directory, and here, okay, so let's get our device here, and let's try to load a standard sketch. Okay, I'm using here this analog serial sample. Okay, I'm uploading it on the board. Not really. Let me see. Okay. Okay, let's change the port. Okay, okay. Okay, so now we're uploading the code. This is just writing a value, like a value of an analog port. So you can see that just, okay, dumping these values here. Okay, so now let's go back. And let's start to, the first thing we need to do is dumping the code from the AVR. So, okay. Okay, this is the syntax we need to use. We saw it also during the presentation. So we need to run the AVR node utilities with the proper MCU and saying that we are going to read and write this file. So let's go on. Okay, now let's go into the ArduSploit directory here and let's copy the dumped content here, and then let's run the ArduSploit script specifying the file. Okay. You see that, okay, it is running for the 80Mega328P, which is the MCU used by the Arduino Uno, and the insert flag is the position where he needs to put our initialization routing. Okay, it's finding the entry points. It says that the timer vector is not used, and so it's inserting payload and saving the injected file. Consider that the script will not modify the original one. It will create a new file named .injected, which we are now going to copy back. So let's copy the resulting file here, which is this one. Okay, let's have a look before copying. Yes. Okay, this is the hex file rewritten by the program itself. Copy. So flash text dot injected in TMP. So let's move flash dot text. So let's rename it, and then okay, I'm just running the same utility as before, but modifying the read to write here. So let's see what happens. Okay, the code is loading. And okay, probably it's, you see that there is a blinking LED now. Okay, let's see if the original function are already there, because okay, we just inserted the code, but we don't know if it's still working as before. So let's go back here. Okay, and so looks like yes, okay, it's still dumping the content of the analog port, but now it also has the blinking LED. Okay, the blinking light here. So we can do another quick example by using a sketch that is using the ISR. So let me just open it. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So let's upload this one. Okay, this is very easy program that just use an interrupt timer to print an A here. Okay, not really a real example, but in any case, for the purpose of the test, it's enough. So it's printing an A. So let's go back and do the same things here. So let's dump the content again by reading the flash. Okay, let's copy again the slash tmp slash in. Okay, and let's run again the hard exploit. Okay, consider, okay, see, not this one. So the script realized that the timer vector is new, so it tried to append. So now we have the injected code. Let's copy it back. And let's write it. Okay. Okay, so you can see again the blinking light here. And let's see if it still runs the interrupt as before. Okay, yep. So also in the case that the interrupt is in use, it actually keeps the blinking light working here. Okay, so this is more or less, I think that we also, running out of time. Maybe I have still some minutes to do an additional test, which will be the automation of the process here. So let me show you. So this can be, okay, let me. Okay. So this is a starting point, obviously. It would be interesting to also know your opinion about this and to also have your help for developing and do additional things about this this way, also changing maybe the way we are using to inject the code, actually, because this is a solution I found. It's not the only one for sure. Okay, so let me upload again the. Analog read. So I'm going to, okay, get rid of the blinking LED here. Okay, uploading done. So, okay, as you can see, said we can automate the process. This board here has a Python support with the script on board. So if I'm going to plug the board now, we should wait 30 seconds and we should see the LED start blinking again. What it's doing right now is just automating the process we did just 10 minutes ago. So now it's uploading the code again. And okay, as you can see, there is the blinking LED. Okay, so that's all. I hope, okay, everything will be available on GitHub in a few days, just after the conference. So these are the references I use to write everything. If you have any comment or something, I'm here to speak with you, and also I would like to know also your opinion. You can write me or just stop me and how to improve, how to if to develop or do additional things on that. Okay, thank you very much for being here. Thank you so much. Thank you.